how we can tell this virus
wasn't. Now you're saying but that's through mutations then.
Correct, and that's why we can tell this virus didn't come from a natural setting, because of the ACE receptor, and that's a lot more detailed than we need to go into for this show. But anyway, this is
but the bottom, it has to adapt. I mean,
correct.
It's because it's not going to pass along. Because it's mutating constantly and so on, it's finding a way to do it, finding a way to stay alive. You may have a lot of these viruses that can't do it, but if one of them does, that's all you need is one.
And
at that point, it becomes many.
And when we're working with cell lines in the laboratory, they're continuous cell lines, meaning they grow all the time.
Yeah.
That doesn't happen in nature. So we're giving it a huge acceleration the zoonosis in laboratory
manipulation.
Which
even works. Whereas it takes several million years and something like that, we're doing it in a day.
Or a few weeks.
A few weeks or whatever.
So this particular slide, and I show this because again, we're going to go back to vaccines. Mm-hmm. Because when you make a vaccine, you grow a pathogen, an RNA virus or whatever it is, in a tissue, either an animal cell line, fly, mosquito, human,
chickens,
flu vaccine, and we'll talk about that. So I show here particularly Pediarix.
These are two vaccines essentially.
Correct.
That are given to 2-month-old children.
2-month-old infants.
Infants and so on.
2-month, 4-month, 6-month.
And these little letters here all are different diseases. It's a combination.
Yeah, vaccine.
A vaccine
given to a
2-month-old baby.
Correct.
Who doesn't have an immune system.
Correct. And it's really important as we look at this in the context of an emerging zoonosis and emerging viruses. So this is diphtheria, tetanus, acellular pertussis, Hep B, and polio in a single vaccine.
Yeah.
But what's more important is I'm showing here what the CDC table called the excipient list. This is what's in the needle.
Yeah.
And so in order to grow, each of these antigens has a different host that it grows in. So in order to grow these different antigens and make a vaccine by mixing them all together,
Are they making it just antigens? The antigens are what antibodies attach to on the cell. Okay?
Well, so a weakened virus, this polio virus, that's the big problem in this particular one that for today's discussion. That polio virus is a live attenuated virus. And so in order to grow that polio virus, which is an RNA virus, we grow that in vero monkey kidney cells.
Mm-hmm.
What is an intermediate host for coronaviruses? Monkeys.
Yeah, right.
The Ebola. And so vero monkey kidney cells, we grow viruses very well. You know why? They have no type 1 interferon alpha. None.
No.
So you're a little virus replication factory.
Right.
But the problem is they don't clean these out of the vaccines.
I didn't realize the interferon was that important.
Very important. Type 1 interferon, my first job. So at any rate, they don't clean it out of the vaccines. So now this child, should this child be exposed to somebody who has a coronavirus, they've got the makings of the coronavirus right there, and Ebola and HIV, because they have the genetics and the viruses that were in vero monkey kidney cells injected into this child, and you're a factory for something else, and you've stimulated a very strong immune response with the aluminum hydroxide and the aluminum phosphate. I mean, these children, especially vaccinated children, if exposed to this coronavirus, wouldn't survive.
Mm-hmm.
The same thing you could say, and I didn't put the excipient, I might have it here for the flu vaccine.
Whereas they might very well, it would just be without this thing, they might very well have had the ability to fight off this.
Correct.
Correct.
They might be, and so would the mothers. And so, unfortunately, the mothers are being vaccinated as well these days, and that never happened when I was a child or when I was a childbearing age.
I got measles. I didn't have a vaccination.
Correct.
I lived through it. Which, by the way, keep in mind, too, we should add this to it immediately here, too. These vaccines prevent this disease this time around. But unlike the immune system, this is only the immune the innate response. So they, but that doesn't develop an immunity to it.
A lifelong immunity,
adaptive response.
And you can even argue, because there's no research that's ever been done in a 2-month-old, that they don't develop any kind of immunity.
Yeah.
So these, given the way they're given in the 21st century, they're all risk and no benefit.
Yeah.
And all risk. So, but
the benefit has to be beyond. You know, beyond a couple of years, well, a couple of months even, and so on. Otherwise, you're vaccinating them continuously, basically.
Right. Of the retrovirus, this was our work in XMRVs. This was our 2009 science paper that was, you know, basically ended my career, because when the magnitude of this zoonosis, that mouse leukemia, mouse cancer causing viruses, had been transmitted to, for now more than 50 years, I think the first outbreak of myalgic encephalomyelitis and the first cases of autism were a zoonosis that came from a polio vaccine. And remember, in the 30s, in Los Angeles, in the 30s, we vaccinated, we attenuated polio by passing it through mouse brains.
Right.
So we picked up a mouse retrovirus family that is associated with many diseases, cancer, chronic fatigue syndrome, autism, passed it through the doctors. The children got it, the whole family got it. And so the susceptibility here was this gene called RNA cell. So it's like a Pac-Man RNA cell, ACE, it clips. It cleaves all RNAs that are outside the cell, RNA viruses, DNAs. So that's a simplistic way to say it. So this mutation that was found in prostate cancer susceptible people, so only people with prostate cancer that had this R462 mutation, one mutation gave the enzyme about half its ability to degrade these viruses. So those men were more likely to get inflammatory and deadly prostate cancer very young. And so then we, that was where the virus was first identified in 2004, the sequences, and then we found it. And of course, as I mentioned in the slide before, there's cow blood in every vaccine. There are pig retroviruses in the Rotatec. There's vero monkey kidney cells, which carry SIV, which is the progenitor of HIV. And then there's human fetal tissue that contain a lot of endogenous viruses from humans.
So what you're saying basically is the polio vaccine and other vaccines, but polio was kind of, I don't know, pretty much one of the original ones at least. There's been documented cases where people have gotten sick, cancers. I mean, that, keep in mind that for people that don't know, viruses can become cancerous.
Correct.
They just don't make you sick. They give you cancer.
Right. And SV40 is another of the viruses that causes lung cancer, associated with lung cancer and other things. So these zoonoses are not new. And we know of them, and they can be critical because, of course, retroviruses aren't easily cleared, and they take 20 to 30 years to kill the host.
Right.
But
we don't
as
know.
We're
they're giving this thing to two-month-old babies.
Correct.
You may find that 30 years from now.
Well, and what that's exactly what we're seeing.
Isn't it, you
we're
get
seeing
it right now.
Cancers. We're seeing 20-year-olds with breast cancer, triple negative, one of the most aggressive cancers. So this is just what I just said. So how do mouse retroviruses get into human? Well, you take the mice in the conveyor cell.
What is a retrovirus then?
HIV. They have both RNA and DNA.
They
reverse transcribe their RNA into DNA, and they insert themselves into your genome for your life.
Yeah.
So if they hit a stem cell, if they hit a blood cell, an immune cell, you become a little virus factory, and this is what it shows. Mm-hmm. And then we're taking them right, we're mixing them. So I use the blue and the red here. So we just take the mouse and we mix it with those other cell lines.
Yeah.
The cow, the pig, the calf serum, the Vero monkey kidney cells, the MRC5, the human cells. Mm-hmm. And then we take the whole gamish. We don't even clean it up. And we just inject it into a vulnerable infant. And I show a black baby here because that's what we learned in the vax situation with MMR. MMR are three RNA viruses. And so if you have that, blacks and Mexicans and certain other people have more of that R462Q where they can't degrade it as fast. So what we learned is in their enzyme system, their immunity isn't developed until they're 3 years old. Mm-hmm. So what we learned in the data that was covered up by Thompson and the CDC back in 2000 is if they waited until a black child was 3 years old to give MMR, they dropped the relative risk of getting autism by fourfold. And of course, they didn't wait. They just spread it around.
And just because they are a different ethnic background, or what do you want to call
different
it? So
gene
on. Yeah, different
genes.
Yeah, they had more susceptibility. But they got the same vaccine.
Correct.
Which had been tested on white kids, I said, I guess, and so on.
It wasn't tested on anyone, actually.
Tested on anyone, okay.
So everybody had more of a risk because the contaminants haven't been advertised.
Yeah.
So I just show a simple slide of what I call 21st century acquired AIDS, acquired endocannabinoid, because the endocannabinoid system, now we know we have an endogenous system of ion channels and channels which can send signals to the immune system and calm everything down, and that's cannabis as therapy. So I'm proposing for coronaviruses, for emerging viruses, for zoonosis, to prevent tissue injury, we can use cannabis if we use it in a rational way.
Be tested, you know.
Absolutely.
When you say cannabis, of course, everybody thinks of marijuana and so on, but that's not the same thing at all. This is cannabis, which is very natural again. You know, keep that in mind. Very natural in nature.
We're not talking heating up smoking. We're talking about taking a plant in nature and taking cannabinoids that we know will calm down that fire. So the endocannabinoid system in simplistic terms is a system whereby it's a dimmer switch on that inflammation.
Yeah.
So in the beginning when I said if the fire gets too high in humans because they can't clear the reactive oxygen species fast enough, it doesn't do that in bats. Well, the endocannabinoid system is a system where with a plant you can put the dimmer switch on it. You can not the on and off switch, the dimmer switch.
Yeah.
Just stop the flames of the fire, the inflammation. Stop the flames from going that high.
Mm-hmm.
About in Liberia, and these were our NIH directors, and when you inject a vaccine and bypass things or do anything where you mix blood, because of course in HIV AIDS it was the blood supply that was heavily contaminated and spread that through the susceptible populations.
Yeah.
And interestingly enough, until very recently, we didn't vaccinate AIDS patients because we knew we would kill them. We would spread the virus through their body where we could shut it down if we allowed the natural immunity to work, which was of course some of my PhD thesis in the role of the macrophage in controlling the disease.
Yeah.
So in 2014, I show here from an article in
Scientific Reports,
Scientific American or something like this. So
yeah.
Here's what the CDC said when it was very clear that the Ebola in Liberia didn't spread through blood and body tissues, that it had been aerosolized, that it could be spread the same way as the emerging coronaviruses we're talking about right now.
Yeah.
So the CDC says, well, it's not contagious because when you cough with measles, it goes 6 feet. I'm not sure how they count counted the drops. And if you cough with Ebola, it only goes 3 feet. Therefore, you don't have to worry about it, folks. So this is the kind of media, and we're seeing it in our media today, the lies that are being told by our governments and our labs about these outbreaks and about the origin.
Well, that makes not so much lies that they don't understand it themselves.
They do. They do. I mean, they do. I think my two books will tell you. Well, here's Harold Varmus, and he was the NIH director, and he implemented the xenotransplantation program in 1999. We remember when we used to use pig aortas and veins for heart transplants. We didn't put those in HIV-infected people because of the risk. Xenotransplantation, you take foreign tissue, xenotransplantation,
right.
Take foreign tissue, xeno, and put it in another species. And then that runs the risk of transmitting or accelerating a zoonosis because, of course, a patient with HIV is compromised because the HIV is compromised, the immune system. So they said in some cases, the viruses that are not pathogenic in their natural hosts can, in some cases, become pathogenic when transmitted to a new species. Mm-hmm. So they said this in 1999. And we knew this. We've known this for most of my entire adult career. And we were talking about your friend with Lyme disease.
Yeah.
So it's no different than the multi-component animal viruses from mosquitoes. So what accompanied the Zika outbreak and the emergence in Brazil, which according to the news, caused the microcephaly, the people born with deformed brains and small brains and from pregnant women. And so that the Zika was, you know, supposedly passed through, you know, mosquitoes, but or animals are just somehow zoonosed into humans. But at that time, what they were doing in Brazil was they were spraying the natural environments and they released some engineered mosquitoes to the area and then did spraying with a lot of pesticides. And then they vaccinated with DTP.
They were testing this thing on mosquitoes, but unfortunately, some of the mosquitoes escaped. Is that what you're saying?
Well, they released them on purpose,
as
a way to control, theoretically, other, playing God as a way to control the mosquito population or pathogenic mosquitoes.
Right.
But what in fact they did was they caused the zoonosis of the Zika, which is also an RNA virus.
Because it mutated?
No, because the animals under stress. When even bats in the rainforest there, they took them out of their natural environment and put them under stress by all the spraying, and then they released mosquitoes that were engineered to produce other things. And this paper is a 2016 paper which shows they could get all kinds of viruses out of those mosquitoes. Mm-hmm. And so you think about, an expanded host range to include monkeys. So now here's a multi-component animal virus. And again, this is published, you know, 5 years ago. So when you say they don't know, you know, and nobody sees this in the news. Nobody sees this fanfare. And we think about Lyme, which is Borrelia, you know, ticks. And ticks have been weaponized and released. You know, we've always had ticks in our environment. Why do we have this explosion of tick-borne diseases?
Right.
Well, it's the crippling, and because there are other pathogens emerging that are crippling other halves of the site. So these are being caused by our manipulation of animal tissue. Mm-hmm. And then this one shows you, this is the MMR5. So this is a recent MMR vaccine, and an independent group over in Italy got a hold of some because, again, these vaccines have never been tested. You know, we don't know what's in them. Nobody's an expert because we don't know what's in them. We can't even guess. But this group got some vaccines.
They don't know what's in them.
Because they're not tested.
What they think is in them, but it turns out to be turns out that there's other things in it.
Right. And they won't test them, and they haven't been safety tested,
right,
as we know. As and that was actually admitted by the WHO and the CDC, that these vaccines are killing people and that there's a lot of contaminants. And yes, you know, they've never been safety tested as required by law since 1986.
Yeah.
Not a single test. So here's an independent study that shows, you know, 32 sequences of a human endogenous retrovirus that's associated with a lot of diseases like Lou Gehrig's disease, again, explosion of these diseases. Equine, this is a horse anemia virus. Two of those, avian leukosis virus, it destroys your white blood cells from birds, and 32, four sequences of
what you're saying, these viruses were in that.
These were all in MMR.
And they don't, didn't, oh,
and that.
I guess it's worse, they really didn't know it. They didn't test it, so they didn't really know what was in it.
Well, but it's mandated by law to be injected in our children or they don't go to school.
Yeah.
So this is our problem.
Yeah.
So it's all right if you want to take this stuff, but we don't have informed consent.
Yeah.
We're being lied to about what's in these, and then it's being mandated by law or our ability
to have
a job.
Well, it's not so much that they lied to, and so they didn't know what's in there.
Well, they won't test
it. These children are becoming guinea pigs.
And our adults.
Yeah.
With every flu vaccine,
well, they become
they're
adults,
not tested.
And then, you know, like I say, 30 years from now, you really don't know what caused this to happen. Well, it's because you got a vaccination of something that really weren't sure about.
And
they had never tested it.
That's what we're seeing, and you know, as required by law.
Yeah.
I mean, I tested this for years. So
we only got a few minutes left here, so.
Well, and this just shows you the antiviral pathway of the cannabinoids, so that we can start thinking they're natural product medicines.
Mm-hmm.
So the cannabinoids here's type 1 interferon. So they block that inflammatory tissue damaging response.
Mm-hmm.
They'll control the fire, as I mentioned, and they'll stimulate the production of type 1 interferons. So you can take a cannabinoid formulation from hemp, as you just said, non-psychoactive, and you can dampen the pathology that would kill you, and spray some type 1 interferons in a homeopathic form. Diseases they were causing.
Which you were very much involved in.
Which, and I only learned the hard way.
Yeah.
But in the plague of corruption, it starts really from 2014. Stuff that I didn't know that we've even talked about tonight. And what I said is, in plague of corruption, we raise the broader question of the enormous risk of using animal tissue in research and mixing it with human tissue for the development of medical therapies while covering up the value and the efficacy of natural product therapies like cannabis, homeopathy, energetics therapies, like we've talked on this show about, we've talked about electroporation. And so the energetic therapies are healing as well, including even light therapy. We can restore and reverse some of the Alzheimer's effects with different light energies, different therapies with light. So the plague of corruption, that's why we titled it this way, and Frank coined the phrase restoring faith in the promise of science.
Mm-hmm.
As you know from this show, and why you do it is medical hope. We have huge promise for science. We have the technologies to do these things. We can catch these outbreaks very quickly. And if we don't censor the truth when an unfortunate, inconvenient truth comes out, like a practice that we thought might be risky, and we ignored the risk and allowed the emergence of new strains of pathogenic
virus. I've got a couple minutes left here. One thought that there's a paper out today, I guess it is, from the University of Texas, Austin. Mm-hmm. Here's a tool, you're talking about the science, a tool that they have. They've been able to sequence the genome of this new coronavirus, this N. COV, but what they're trying to, the last paragraph of their paper, at least what part that I read and so on, they're taking people who have basically survived this. There's only 2% now, but 2% of the people who will get it end up dying, and that's of course old people and babies and people who have a compromised immune system to begin with. But because the fact that these people can do the, and again, here it is. They get the same, they get the innate response, but they have the adaptive response, the antibodies, which means antibodies, basically.
Correct.
antibodies, little soldiers running around your body and so on, looking for this same virus. If it shows up again, they got it, right?
Right.
Getting those